بسم الله، الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Tonight, inshallah, we are going to continue with the lessons from the lives of the prophets. Allah now has destroyed the people of Nuh. What happened was, we reached from last week, when they refused Nuh alayhi salam's advice and commands and direction, and only the minor people followed him, people from who were farmers, who didn't have much of a status in society, and the rest of them were too proud to follow because of the low status of people who followed him. So Allah told him, build the ark. He built it. And Allah said to the skies to open up with its water, and the earth to overflow with its floods. And among the people who drowned was the son of Nuh alayhi salam. The son of Nuh alayhi salam, he disbelieved. And he said, Father, I will go to the high mountains and it will save me. But his father said, there is no savior from Allah today. And soon the waves came and took his son before his eyes. Nuh alayhi salam requested, said, Ya Rabb, you promised me you're going to save me, my family, and my son is one of my family. Allah said, Ya Nuh, he is not one of your family. I promised you that I will save the family that believed. As for those who didn't believe, I told you I will not save. So therefore he is not from the family that I said I will save. Nuh alayhi salam immediately repented to Allah. And Allah said, Inni a'idhuka an takuna min al-jahilin. I admonish you. I say, a'idhuka. I'm admonishing you, Ya Nuh. I'm reminding you heavily. Don't be among the ignorant. Immediately Nuh alayhi salam prostrated to Allah and sought his forgiveness. And this is where we left off, that we should never delay the repentance from any sin. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, everything hastening in it is from the shaitan. Al-ajala min ash-shaytan. Hastening is from the shaitan in everything except for three things. He said, you should haste to get married. As in, don't delay your marriage when you're able to. Don't say, oh, I'll get married when I'm 30 or when I'm whatever. When you're able to, get married as quick as possible. Get yourself ready fast. That's what it means. Get yourself ready fast. Some people, they say, I'm not ready yet, but I'm going to marry straight away. Not like that. You're putting harm to that woman. Get ready fast. Prepare yourselves quick. Number two, reconciliation. You're upset with your brother. You're upset with your family. Something's happened. Do not delay the reconciliation. Don't stay apart for a long time. Rasulullah said, hasten towards reconciliation. Reconcile between two people quickly. Don't delay it. And thirdly, in repentance. If you sin, do not delay it. Don't say tomorrow. Don't say next week. The year after. No. You immediately repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because we don't know when we are going to die. And Rasulullah said, the person will be raised on the last ways that he died upon. So the last lifestyle that you had. And also the sins that you had accumulated last. But if you had repented, this is the biggest reward that you can get to see in your book on the Day of Judgment. Nuh alayhi salam repented and said, oh my Lord, forgive me for my ignorance. Now, the water actually rose. And a brother asked me before last week, he said, brother, did the flood cover the whole world or regions of the world? There is a difference of opinion actually among our scholars. The water, did it cover the whole world or did it cover a region? Only Allah really knows the answer to that. We can't really tell from the hadiths and the sources in the Quran. But what we do understand, whether it was the whole world or the region, what is unanimous is that every single human died except for the ones that were saved on the ark. In other words, the disbelievers were gone because of Nuh alayhi salam's dua, and only the believers were left. That was the dua of Nuh alayhi salam, and that was what was responded to. So some scholars, they say, for the flood to go everywhere else in the world where there is no people, defeats the purpose of the dua. Because the dua was specific. It didn't say, oh my Lord, destroy the world and its animals and habitats. Get rid of it all, flood it all. Rather, he said, destroy and get rid of the disbelievers because there is no more hope in them. God had told him there's no more hope in them. None of us is allowed or permitted to ever say, this person or that group has no hope. This is actually blasphemy. This is shirk in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't know the future. We don't know who's going to heaven or hell in specific. We can only say what Allah said. But here Allah had told Nuh alayhi salam وأوحي إلى نوح. Allah said, we inspired, we sent Jibreel عليه السلام from above with a message from us to tell him أنه لن يؤمن إلا من آمن. No one is going to believe anymore except those who had already believed. In other words, فلا تأس على القوم الكافرين. Do not feel sorry for those who have disbelieved. That's it. No one's going to believe. So when Nuh alayhi salam knew that from Allah he had told him there is no more hope, he said, then, oh my Lord, I seek you, your pardon, and I request you to rid all of them. Because if you leave them, they're going to give birth to worse people and worse people and worse people. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responded to his dua. That was the dua of Nuh alayhi salam. Every messenger has a special major dua. The great dua of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is why we love him the most. He said, oh my Lord, I want you to save my followers on the day of judgment. I want you to make me an intercessor on that day to ask you, save my ummah, and you that you would respond. And that's why truly on that day, we will go to all the prophets from Adam to Nuh, from Nuh alayhi salam, from Idris to Nuh alayhi salam, to Ibrahim alayhi salam, to Hud and Salih, to Musa alayhi salam, and Musa alayhi salam and Isa, until we reach Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he will say, ana laha, ana laha. I am the one for it, I am the one for it. Allah says in the Quran about the ark and how it sailed. He said,
قال اركبوا فيها بسم الله مجريها ومرساها.
Allah said to them, climb onto it and say Bismillah, in the name of Allah it's directed, and in the name of Allah it flows, it sails. In another verse in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us another dua of riding on boats or on ships, riding in your car or riding on animals. And the dua is, فَإِذَا اسْتَوَيْتَ, Allah says in the Quran, and when you are on top of it, on top of your transport vehicle, then say,
سبحان الذي سخر لنا هذا وما كنا له مقرنين وإنا إلى ربنا لمنقلبون.
Glory be to Allah who has made this transport accessible to me, to us. And we were not his partners in doing so. Whether it's a car, Allah created the metal for it and the fuel for it. Whether it's an animal, Allah created the animal. In the air or in the ship, it was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who created the physics and the material for us to be in it. وَإِنَّا إِلَىٰ رَبِّنَا لَمُنْقَلِبُونَ, and to Allah we will all return. This is the dua that we should learn to say and teach your children when you drive transport in the car or on a bus or on an animal, if you're living back in Turkey or Lebanon or Bosnia or back in Somalia somewhere, wherever you are, India, if you ride on animals over there, this is the dua you teach them, or in the aeroplane or on the ship. You always say Bismillah, meaning in the name of Allah this has been made accessible to us, in the name of Allah we ride, in the name of Allah we reach our destiny. So Bismillah when we climb and Bismillah when we climb off. And so Allah taught Nuh alayhi salam this dua when he went on the ship. Bismillahi majriha wa mursaha. In the name of Allah, it is guided, and in the name of Allah, it sails. And Allah says in the Quran,
وَهِيَ تَجْرِي بِهِمْ فِي مَوْجٍ كَالْجِبَالِ وَنَادَى نُوحٌ ابْنَهُ.
Now, we go back a little bit, but the point I want to say of this, and if you looked at the ark, at the way that it sailed, it was sailing. Allah is describing the way it was sailing. It was sailing around or in between waves the size of mountains. كالجبال, waves the size of mountains. You know, any hill, any mountain. Waves that size, that's how humongous this flood was. And the ark was sailing in that. And the way Allah taught Nuh alayhi salam to build the ark was in a way where it was covered from the top, arched, and on the bottom arched, in a way where it doesn't get flooded, the water just drops right off it, flows right off it, and it doesn't sink. So Allah said that it was such a powerful and well-designed ship that it was traveling in waves the size of mountains, كالجبال, as Allah says in the Quran. And then he talks about how Nuh alayhi salam called to his son. Because that's he's giving two scenarios in one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then when the matter was ended, in the hadith it says, and there are differences of opinions on how high exactly the water reached, but Ibn Abbas, Ibn Mas'ud and others, they say that the water reached higher than the highest point of the world by 30 cubits. Some said 300 yards or whatever. The point is, the water actually reached, according to their narrations and to the hadiths, that the water actually reached the highest peak of the highest place on earth. Was it the whole earth or was it the region? Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exactly knows the answer to that. But the point is, it reached so high that no one could even reach the highest peak to save themselves from there. As the son of Nuh alayhi salam claimed, I will go to a mountain. Allah made the water reach above the highest mountain. So there's no way. There was absolutely no way to escape the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters in Islam, this is to analyze the power of Allah. How dare us ever challenge Him, subhanahu. You know, for those of us who actually really analyze the greatness of Allah, His power, His ability, wallahi, they'll be dumbfounded and fabbled. And no one will dare to challenge and even talk something about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a negative way. Allahu Akbar, immediately you fall to your knees. Immediately you fall to your knees. And when I was watching once this, just a few weeks ago, a tornado. It was talking about the history of a tornado that happened a few years back in America, in one of the hearts of the main cities. And the way they redesigned it, a tornado that went past probably for 1.5 minutes. 1.5 minutes destroyed an entire city with high-rise buildings. A whole neighborhood, maybe 7 neighborhoods, were flat to the ground. They ripped the houses apart. Allahu Akbar, when you have a look at it, in 1.5 minutes. What atom bombs, what nuclear weapons, what power of any human being is going to stop something like that? One tornado for 1.5 minutes. Allah tells us, beware of Allah's punishment. Inna akhdahu kana azizan muqtadir. Inna akhdahu azizan muqtadir. Allah, when He takes someone, He takes them with absolute power, absolute ability. No one can stop it. We all know this, but to actually really analyze and appreciate it, you need to look at how Allah destroyed these people. The natural causes which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends. وَمَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّا هُوَ. Allah says, no one knows the soldiers of your Lord except He. He sends breezes, He sends winds, He sends tornadoes. And when you say breeze, what's a breeze? He transforms it into more than any nuclear weapon you've ever known. A lightning strike can destroy a whole neighborhood. One lightning strike, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills. Allahu Akbar. One tornado in 1.5 minutes destroyed 7 cities, with the main city from top to bottom. The cities were built with steel structures, but their windows and everyone inside, this is what they described. They said the tornado, the buildings that were high-rise, they had built and engineered them with steel frames in order to withstand tornadoes. So only the glass on the outside gets destroyed, but the frame stays. But guess what? They couldn't help one thing. The tornado sucked everything from inside the building out. So all the humans were sucked out. Not a single grain, not a single material was left inside those buildings. So to come and suck everything out. Allahu Akbar. The power of Allah, no one should challenge it at all. Abadan. And then they disobey Allah more and more and more and more. And they say, this is nature, this is this, this has got nothing to do with creation of God. Brothers and sisters, Allah destroyed them all. And then Allah says, O sky.
وَقِيلَ يَا أَرْضُ بَلَعِي مَاءَكِ وَيَا سَمَاءُ أَقْلِعِي وَغِيضَ الْمَاءُ وَاسْتَوَتْ عَلَى الْجُودِي.
Allah then said, Only Allah knows how long it stayed. 40 days, 50 days, 100 days, Allahu A'lam. A year, a two, Allahu A'lam how long it stayed before the flood went back down. But Allah said to the earth, O earth, swallow your water. And O sky, stop. Don't rain anymore. And the water slowly began to go down until Allah says, and the ark was settled perfectly on Mount Judi. Allah says in the Quran, على الجودي, on the Judi. Is it a description of a mount? Is it a description of some sort? Or is it in the name of a mountain? Scholars are differed. But a lot of them unanimously agree that it is a mountain called the Mount of Judi. In the Bible, they've got a different mountain, but it's very close to it, you see. But what was Judi at that time and what we consider Judi today are two different things. But what Allah says in the Quran is the truth. It landed on the mountain of Judi. And when it settled there, the ark, subhanAllah, was built on a mountain and landed on a mountain. So you hardly find an ark that high. They say, Wallahu A'lam, I don't know, I've heard this story several times now, that they found the ark or pieces of the ark in Turkey somewhere. I heard this like 10, 15 years ago, and it suddenly was forgotten. And now they go, oh, the other day they discovered it. And I'm thinking, they discovered it then or now or when? But the point is, it is still on earth, and people have discovered it before. Now, Allahu A'lam, if we have or haven't, maybe it's fossilized. Only Allah knows. The point is, Allah said in the Quran,
وَلَقَدْ تَرَكْنَاهَا آيَةً فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرٍ
Allah says, and we left the ark as a sign, as a miracle. Can anyone deny this? So the idea is, at the time of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, this ark was still there, and people found it, and people witnessed it, and people spoke about it, and today they still talk about its fossils, and the scientists are discovering, because they know that the ark is actually still there. So it was sighted, and it was seen. And Allah says, those who are endued with knowledge cannot deny it. Those who read in history cannot deny it. So it was there. It doesn't mean that every single person sees it, but there are members of the human population who do see it and rediscover it and re-talk about it again and again. At that point, Nuh alayhi salam had three sons. They say, the scholars, that these three sons, he had four, and one of them was Yam, who was drowned, he disbelieved, but three of them believed with Nuh alayhi salam. And they tell us that everyone that was boarded on the ark, they had no children. All of them died, and they had no children. They couldn't have any children, except for Nuh alayhi salam and his wife, and they had what their names were, Sam or Sham, Ham, and Yafith. That was their names. Sham or Sam, Ham, and Yafith. Or Shem, Japheth, and Ham. Each of them had three children. From the progeny, like from the offsprings or the loins of Sam or Sham, there came from him the Arabs, the Persians, and the Romans. From Yafith, there came the prosperity of the Turks, some tribe called the Sakalibas, and Ya'juj and Ma'juj, Gog and Magog. And from Ham started the lineage of who they call the Copts, Sudanese, and the Barbars, so the dark-looking people. And from them more colors came out. But the point is, this was a difference in color. So the people of the Turk and the Sakalibas, I think they're the Asian-looking people, and the less Asian, but in that range. And from Sam came the Arabs, the Persians, and the Romans. And from Ham came the lineage of the Copts, the Sudanese, and the Barbar, the extra dark-colored skin people. And this is what is narrated through our historians and through our tabi'een, the children of the companions and some of our companions. The tabi'i who mentioned his name was Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, rahmatullah alayhi. And the scholars unanimously agree, almost unanimously, on this. The point is, it makes sense because these colors of these different nationalities obviously had to start again, had to come back again, and these colors and these different nationalities did come out. Nuh alayhi salam lived on after that. Some of our scholars say another 150 years, and some of them say 250 years maximum. And he left a will behind him to his children. No prophet died except that he left a will. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that we must leave a will. And Allah told us in the Quran, a will is a must. And our scholars tell us that 3 days should not pass by except that a person should revisit their will, make any adjustments or edit it if need be. Especially with debts and rights towards people. Especially if you have children, family, you need to leave a will behind. And the types of will the prophets left was this type of will that Nuh alayhi salam left. Among the first things he said, do not make partners with Allah. That's the most important thing in our whole life. Never make partners with Allah. Teach your children La ilaha illallah, not just by the tongue, but also by meaning. Let them understand that La ilaha illallah, my dear son or daughter, means there is no God worthy of worship except for Allah, and explain it to them what it means. Talk about the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Learn about His Lordship, learn about His worship. Learn these things and what it means to worship only one God. Because, sorry to say this, brothers and sisters, but in our Muslim communities today, because of the lack of understanding and knowledge, subhanAllah, about our deen, especially about Tawheed, people say La ilaha illallah night and day, yet they are doing shirk also night and day, and they don't even know it. And I'm talking about those who believe in fortune telling and superstitions and all these other types of things, and they make shirk night and day. Or they swear oaths by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, I swear on my mother's grave. This is shirk. You are making partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I have to swear an oath only by God. You know, I swear on my life, they say. And as I gave you the examples before as well. Shirk, making partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mocking the religion. Calling it something other than what Allah called it is also shirk. It's like you're judging this religion other than the way Allah judged it. You know, some people, they mock, you know, the ways of the practicing Muslims. They mock the orders of the Quran. They mock the orders of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then they say, no, we love the Quran. But they mock it. They mock its teachings. So this is shirk. This is making partners with Allah in that you are saying, I know better than what Allah came with. I know better than what Allah came with. Some people mock the beards. Some people mock the hijab. Others, they mock the way we pray, the fasting, La ilaha illallah. From among the Muslims, yes, from among the Muslims. And they mock it. You are mocking Allah's religion. This is shirk. You're making partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So be very careful, my brothers and sisters, from shirk. He said, I forbid you from shirk and arrogance or haughtiness. So these are the main, you know, arrogance. To reject the truth when it comes to you and to look down upon others as if you are better, you are higher, you have a higher status, and everybody else should be serving your feet. So this is all part of shirk. Nuh alayhi salam died at the age of over 1,000 years. Some scholars say that he lived the longest out of the prophets, but he was also a messenger of God. He was also among the people, among the prophets who were called Ulul Azm, like the prophets that endured a lot from their people. They strived and struggled a lot. And he was the first among them, Nuh alayhi salam. So alhamdulillah, aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum. Hadha wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Walhamdulillah rabbil alamin.